So yeah, they asked me to sit in at the last minute. When I heard like it was for Jack Cheney, the former vice president of Bush, I said, I would love to sit in for that monster. It's Jack Cheney, I'm sorry. No offense to Jack. Anyway, I think Kate saw something I did the other day about sort of I rage against the machine occasionally. And even though I have a machine, it's still a mom and pop. So I straddle this line of like, you know, mom and popism and, you know, trying to run sometimes a machine. We're lucky enough to be busy and have a few restaurants. And so I talked about culture or raging against corporate culture because, man, corporate culture is a dangerous thing. I'll say number one, I was in the lobby with Daniel and we both realized that champagne is cheaper than water. That's corporate culture at work, right? That's when you have champagne, it's cheaper than water, or vodka that's cheaper than water. Things are messed up. And you know, corporate culture, to me, the hardest thing is to be a mom and pop and to be authentic, right? And so it's like, how do you do that when you have a lot of employees and a lot of restaurants? Well, I think to me, seeing what corporate culture has done sort of led me to a little bit of my philosophies at the restaurant. You know, the biggest lies, like, I won't put the check in your mouth, the cum is in the mail, all those things are just like corporate culture at work. And I was saying the other day that Welch's, which has been around forever, I mean, Welch's has been around since the 1890s. And I saw a commercial the other day, and on that commercial, they used the word, our grapes come from a farm. And I realized that I had grown up eating Welch's, and I looked online about Welch's, and I think for the last 100 years, they never mentioned the word farm. So it's like, why in 2017, for grapes that were always grown on a farm, that were always probably produced by a farmer, why now are they using the word farm? So it's like those kind of things that make corporate culture very suspect, very untransparent, and very strategic. They know what we want to hear. And that's a bad thing, right? Because we're kind of easy to fool, right? And we want to be fed this line. And so corporate culture knows how to feed us this line. So as growing up, as Katie said, in a restaurant, like the thing I didn't want to be, and I think the thing I'm going to talk about, is about being the mom and pop. And one of the main things my grandfather said when I grew up there, every time I had an idea, every time I wanted to suggest something, whether it was a great idea or a really bad idea, he would kept telling me, like, don't fix it if it's not broke. Very good saying, right? It's been handed down from generation to generation. Don't fix it if it's not broke. And the Waverly Inn was by no means broke. It was there for almost 150 years at that time. It was an 1844 carriage house and was really a restaurant since the 1920s. So why would I, at 18, a college dropout, think I knew anything about a restaurant enough to try and fix it? So the other thing about growing up in a family restaurant is like, and you guys are all independent restaurants, so this might resonate. Like I was thinking about it, I was like, you're either, every restaurant that's independent is either like Lord of the Flies or an episode of Jerry Springer. Where do you want to be in there? I don't want to be in either. Both of those are pretty fucked up situations to like run a restaurant in. And if you really think about the things that go on day in and day out with people in mom and pops, it's, trust me, it's Lord of the Flies or Jerry Springer. So to me, like the thing you don't need is sometimes the thing you absolutely need. And that thing was the corporate culture piece. I will say one other thing that the don't fix it unless it's broke to me is completely the opposite. I think it's the opposite because in this day and age, or if you want to try and like, you know, evolve and subscribe to that. And that was probably the word I think I used at the first staff meeting at Root Down, because I had no clue if this was going to fail, if it was going to be successful. I had no clue if I was even married to how we were doing things. I said, we are going to evolve, that much I can tell you. So anybody who, you know, is not subscribing to evolution, who believes in Jesus wrote a dinosaur, I think I said that exactly, get out, because we're not going to be talking about Jesus riding a dinosaur. We are going to be talking about evolution a lot. And I think to me, the evolution part is just so important. So I think the real, and you like my slides? Sorry. So I brought my own slides, and I just want you guys to check it out. Okay, so can you all see this? So on this slide, I kind of laid out the five ways that I think, I think it's, you need to fix it so it doesn't break. And what I mean there is, I love my iPhone, right? And when iPhone 1 came out, I don't think anything could have been more perfect than that. It was like Jesus, or not Jesus, it was like God delivering a baby to us that was so perfect. It was like 0 years old, it was not flawed, it had no sin, and it was the most perfect thing. So why did Apple, day after day, year after year, continue to massage, evolve, update, right? Because now when we look at iPhone, whatever on, and if you have a Samsung, I'm sorry, please leave the building. I forgot to ask that up front. I am not brand specific, but Samsung, just do not, you should not be here. But for the iPhone, honestly, like, why would they, we had never seen anything that glorious a thing, and yet, updates, yet iPhone 2, iPhone 3. So I think, to me, the takeaway there is, you better fix it so it doesn't break. And I think things are moving so fast. I think the ideas that we all hold true to us, as chefs, as restaurateurs, to me, I think need to be challenged. And I think if they could be challenged internally, culturally, from a bunch of idea, you know, people within your company, I think those ideas have to be challenged. And I think I wish there was more fixing things. Because when's the last time a successful restaurant in here said, you know what, we're going to redo our complete training manual. You know what, we're going to completely redo something that worked for us for years. And I know that's a scary idea, but I do think it has to start there to innovate change in a way that's going to be meaningful for the guest. Because as we know, there's 1,000 restaurants opening up like every week here. And I'm all for that. I think that's the best thing that can happen to Denver, is more blood and more, you know, bodies and more mouths, and that sounded really wrong. So just more people eating and, you know, sort of sharing ideas. But I do think that there needs to be more of this fix it before it breaks. So I don't know, kind of when you have a saying, you really don't have to say anything more about it. So I'm going to fill here for a couple minutes. I think I got a couple minutes left. I wrote down a couple of things that I think are really important to keep in mind about this sort of corporate culture idea. If we can't agree in these Lord of the Flies and Jerry Springers, now I'm going to preach for a little bit. If we can't agree, right, because I think this idea of like talking about things in a very like important way, conflict resolution is really important. I've found this many years into the business, if we can't all sit at a table and agree, everybody is fucked up. We are all broken people, and I don't mean that anybody personally here. I just mean when it comes to conflict resolution, who has it right? So to me, the thing that I think I've, you know, come at after that corporate talk is somebody asked me, you know, about like how do you use corporate things in a way that's meaningful to your business? And the thing that came to mind, which led me to this last thought, was that we use write-ups and we use, you know, coaching and sit-down and reviews. And I thought, when I opened my business, I would never do a review in my life. I would never do a write-up in my life. I would never do these sit-downs. But I think these sit-downs and these write-ups and all these things are just a meaningful way to do conflict resolution. And I think to me, if it was my choice, I would have been talking about conflict resolution today. Because in the restaurant, every year, I spend more time in conflict resolution than just about anything else. That to me is like the human part of it. And I just think if we can have more meaningful dialogues about conflict resolution and how we set these rules about and we tell people what we want them to do and they come in and they don't do it, so then we ascribe why. Well, they probably went out drinking last night. Yeah, well, he's just lazy. She's just totally cranky this week. So those are just like all excuses of like maybe a why. But the reality is if we can't practice more meaningful conflict resolution and we can't have those dialogues where you sit at a table and say, I want to be honest here with you. I want you to be honest with me. Here's what I would like to see from you. What would you like to see from us? What are the tools you need? We often find that in that conflict resolution, there's something that the said person on the other side never felt comfortable to talk about until you lay out some ground rules. So I do really think it's important, this idea that when you go to talk to somebody and you, in the middle of a shift, and talk to them and say, hey, I need you to be more aware of this. I need you to make sure you're being clean in your station, and you walk away and you think you're done. I think that's like just the beginning. If you're lucky, you're done. If you have somebody who's just got their shit together, great. Hire a bunch of Obamas and you'll have a great kitchen. I think he's got his shit together. But when you hire real people with real lives and real families and real situations who take real substances and do real things to their body, that when you get older, you stop doing, those things are going to affect you. And we're in a business when most of our employees are probably 20 to 30. So any of you who's not 20 to 30, remember what you did then and ask yourself, yeah, I probably wouldn't be too motivated either to go fucking put some bread plates out and some, you know, some stale butter, right? So it's like, how do we get them to want to put out the stale bread and the broken butter plates? I think to me, it's about conflict resolution and how you lay out the ground rules as a culture of just real talk. Last thing, because I think I'm out of time. If you think about it, waking hours, you probably spend a third of your life, if you're lucky enough to have a spouse, with your spouse. That's awesome. Think of how much work goes into a relationship, right? Whether it's a spouse, a girlfriend, a casual encounter, whatever it is, it takes a lot of work from your soul. But the point is, if you spend a third of your life with that person, look how much energy you put into it. I think in restaurants, we spend about a third of our other waking life with our employees, with our coworkers. Do we put in that work that's equal to that third? I don't think so. And that to me is the takeaway, is like, can we all agree that if we're gonna spend a third of our lives together in a room, in a box, serving other people as servants, there needs to be some real talk about stuff and real dialogue. And you know, some of those corporate rules of I'm the manager, so you do it because I say it, you can't express these things at work, leave your shit at the door. I think we need to tear down those rules and just have some real talk, one-on-one, two-on-one, and really break down some of those walls. Because the thing I keep running into is that it's just real life, and it's broken, and it's imperfect. And the best thing we could do is talk about it and get some sort of, you know, sort of cultural or personal synergy out of those moments so that we can turn them into a win. And I think when you do those things, I think that relationships that you create or connect to, I think are so powerful that they sometimes do way more work than a coaching session or my slide presentation, which I feel like you in the back row did not read, and that's kind of pissing me off. So I'm going to now hand this out to each one of you. But I do think it does a lot of work when you are done in really, you know, moving the goals of the company further in a way that I don't think I ever really thought was possible until I started getting dirty. So my other last question, thank you very much, is why is there like a porn shooting here? Because like there's plastic on the seats and no one's sitting in the front row. So I'm going to sit in the front row next. Thank you, guys.